Last year, I actually got a guy off Denburn Bridge. He was about to jump, so I've been, you know, it was something that was massive. I've never done that before.
This is a film about men killing themselves.
Who's thought about suicide before?
It's a film about desperation.
Sometimes people would have abscesses and they'd be injecting into open abscesses.
And it's about a mother sick from grief.
You'll be sick.
Men in Scotland are killing themselves with drink, drugs, and by suicide in increasingly alarming numbers. I want to investigate one simple question: why?
Growing up, where the men are the ones who go out and earn for the family, that's suddenly taken away. What do you replace it with?
I want to find out how Scotland became the drug death capital of Europe and whether these factors contributed to it. This is one of the most challenging films I've ever made.
Why the fuck would I sit here and talk to you? I'm fucking hurting.
I can see how painful it is.
But by the end of it, hopefully we'll find out if there's a solution. But first, Scotland has a rich industrial history. Men wore their working class roots as a badge of honour, and it shaped their inimitable sense of humour.
Should be a toilet or something to behold. So if the guy at the end did a wee jobby, it went shoo.
But there hasn't been much to laugh about over the last 40 years. Since the 1980s, the Scottish economy has undergone major changes. 2.8 million people in Scotland, over half of the population, receive some sort of security benefit or tax credit. Brian Scott is one of them. He's lived in Glasgow all his life, worked as an NHS nurse, but after a hard fall onto concrete, he was physically unable to continue work and forced to sign on. He described how a life on benefits has left him feeling low, and how the process left this once proud nurse feeling humiliated.
My biggest thing is lack of control. You don't control your life. Other people control your life. Sometimes I've left assessments feeling humiliated. I remember once coming out from a meeting with a welfare rights officer and I broke into tears. I just couldn't make head nor tail of the forum. Asking about your toilet habits. Are you able to dress yourself? Can you pick up your trousers? Can you put on your underwear? You're kind of trying to answer in a way that's truthful, but in a way that's not embarrassing the heck out of you. And that's all it takes to kind of knock you off balance for the rest of the assessment.
Brian's experience is one shared by many men that saw their livelihoods gradually disappear because of deindustrialisation. Postle Park, a once thriving area, is now one of the most deprived parts of Scotland, where male life expectancy is just 66 years old. He explained to me the impact this had on his community.
Because if you meet someone, what's the first thing they ask you after they ask your name is, what do you do? When you're taking that away, that's a big part of your identity taken away. There were three big employers that were all based within a mile, so all that went. So you didn't just have one factory closing down with hundreds of people suddenly being laid off. You had like a whole community being laid off, and that's also why I put a lot of people turned to drugs as well, because there was nothing else for them.
Life was bleak, and then the financial crash in 2007, and then austerity. With fewer jobs, lower wages, and less welfare, people began to find solace in drink and drugs.
I did.
In central Glasgow, I met Peter Crikens. He's a former drug user turned activist, helping people overcome their addictions. He didn't have the easiest start in life.
I took drugs from age 11 all the way through my teenage years. I became an injecting drug user by the age of 17. It just all became too much for me.
Train spotting doesn't paint a romantic picture of Scottish drug use. Peter took me to an alleyway, 20 metres from the high street, but I wasn't prepared for what he showed me next.
I mean, so yeah, we're looking at here, we've got spoons, needles.
So you've got your needle, you've got your filter, you've got your spoon, you've got your citric acid, and you've also got a swab. People are coming here and injecting in the conditions that are really unsterile, human feces, discarded clothes, people constantly peeing in this corner as well, you know. When you're out here and you're rushing, you know, because people will just do it as quickly as possible, they'll often miss, which then it leads to abscesses and infections and stuff like that, because people do tend to, even if they have got veins that they could access, if it's cold, people will be injecting in their groin.
It seemed the pull to get high was so strong that a shit-filled alleyway is no deterrent. Our cameras had only been rolling for 5 minutes when someone interrupted us to shoot up.
All right.
Yeah, good.
Aye. Going for a hit? He's having heroin, so it'll not be long.
So, what's the solution? Listen to Boris Johnson or Priti Patel, and it's a renewed war on drugs.
We're seeing a lot of problems caused by these 300,000 problem drugs users.
But what about a more compassionate approach? PETA created a space for users to safely inject, although that wasn't without its problems. There was pushback from some local shopkeepers, and the police were less than impressed. I challenged him with these criticisms.
There's actually no valid argument against these sites. We supervised about 1,000 injections, roughly. You know, we intervened in a number of overdoses. We kept a few people alive. We're just asking for a place where people can inject instead of that rat-infested alleyway that we're standing a couple of yards from, you know.
Nearly 50% of all deaths due to accident or violence in 2018 had drug use as their underlying cause, compared to just 3% in 1981. Scottish men are self-destructing. The two leading causes of death among 15 to 44-year-old men in Scotland are drug-related deaths and suicides. It's been that way for the last 20 years. This is Jack. His friends love his dark humour. An internet entrepreneur with so much potential. His mum's convinced he'll be a millionaire one day. But sadly, that day will never come. On the 22nd of July, Jack took his own life. I met his family on the day they collected his ashes.
He broke up with his girlfriend. He was struggling with it. Said he was going for a bike ride to clear his head. Ended up killing himself.
He sent me a picture of him on top of the building, looking down. He gets to the barrier and he just jumps over. Hearing that noise and then looking over is just replays in my head a lot.
He walked into my room. That's it. I'm sleeping, go away. I was like, oh, Mum, I need you to come downstairs. I knew what he was going to say to me, but I didn't want to hear it. The moment of life changed forever.
And then, the hardest question I've ever had to ask, to a broken father who'll never see his son again. How do you cope?
It keeps catching me, you know, I'm doing, I'm alright, then you break. Then you hear music, then you break. Then you smell something, you break. You hear something, you break. You look at him, you break. Look at her, you break. And that's why as a man, like, you get shamed and, I don't know, it's weak for you to talk about your emotions and do this and that, but what you make a day when you open your mouth and nothing comes out? There's no words. There's just pain and anguish.
I don't think people realise what they actually leave behind.
Dude, I'll be honest, I don't know what's fucking worse. Us sitting here with the aftermath or how alone he felt. You know? You okay? You gotta be sick.
Okay, I'm in.
Thank you, guys.
No. They'll not be easy for you guys either.
Yeah.
You know, nobody wants to talk to you.
Yeah,
like,
I know.
Why the fuck would I sit here and talk to you? I'm fucking hurting.
I can see how painful it is.
After meeting the Fraser family, it's clear Jack felt alone, even though he was surrounded by people that loved him. I wondered, how many other men could relate to this in Scotland? Across the country, men are forming new friendships based on their mutual experiences of addiction, isolation, and low self-esteem, allowing them to open up about their emotions to other people.
I love my grey hair. My height. I'm happy with my height.
I love the fact that I get to help people every single day.
Proud of being sober and clean today. I never thought I could ever be sober and clean.
I'm now really proud of the things that I was once really crippled with anxiety of.
This is Gregor. He's turned his life around with the charity Men Matter Scotland, a community-led initiative helping people regain a sense of belonging.
Thanks for coming along. This is Men Matter Scotland's hub here in Drumchapel.
Cool.
Come on in, I'll show you. I'll show
that.
You the next room.
That,
this is Andy and Tam.
Nice to meet you, lads.
All right, mate.
Gregor told me they help men feel proud again by breaking down the pressures of stereotypical masculinity.
I'd still feel really embarrassed going to a food bank. 100%. I really would, man. And we have a toy bank for the guys who, it's about dignity. If you can't afford to buy your child a toy, that's really that's undignified, and it puts pressure on you, emotional pressure that makes you feel like you're a bad parent, etc. So try to eliminate all these things.
It became clear from speaking to Gregor that there's help available, but it's woefully inadequate and more needs to be done.
The human cost of suicide and, again, like drug deaths, alcohol deaths, any loss of human life is absolutely tragic. And like you said, the ripples of that affect
immediate family, the wider community.
The financial cost to communities and the state for one suicide, that financial number could be as high as £800,000 per individual suicide. So if we're talking about asking for small investment to keep our doors, for example, open, we're a community group.
It's infuriating because, like, obviously what you guys are doing here is brilliant. Like, you know, you're taking care of vulnerable people and you're trying to help them. But isn't there an element of, like, the community shouldn't have to be after doing it for itself?
You are being sent from pillar to post seeking support for your mental health. Everywhere you go, there is nowhere for you to be seen. And even if you are seen, you go and speak to a therapist and then your session's over. And it's like your life's back over to you now. If you're anything like me, I'm like a sponge, I soak stress up. But if you don't have that place to cry if you need to and express and paint, punch a punch bag, talk to somebody or chill.
My time in Scotland had come to a close. I came looking for an answer to the appalling number of drug deaths, alcohol deaths and suicides.
It's not as simple as more money. It's not as simple as increasing government spending. It's about those questions of identity. It's about restoring a sense of pride. And I've been incredibly moved by the people that we've met. In the face of tragedy and trauma, the reaction of some individuals is a desire to help others. The phrase is wanting to share their story in the hope that other people wouldn't have to experience it in the same way.
I just wish he knew that how everybody was feeling at that time. It wasn't going to last forever.
Somebody always loves you. Somebody always fucking cares.
The empathy and selflessness in that is something I won't forget quickly. It's about the content and the strength of your character. Addressing that is, I don't even know how you would go about addressing that or changing that. I mean, it's an extraordinarily complex thing.
But it seems like Scottish men already know what they need. It's just that nobody's listening to them.
A baby's born, everybody thinks it's amazing, it's valuable, it's worthy, it's beautiful, it's precious, and it is. But why do you get to a certain age and all those qualities and characteristics just disappear? They don't. It's just that we view adulthood as a different thing to childhood, but they're still the same people. We're still got the same worth and value, and society wants us to try and forget about that. But as a community, we've got to remind each other that that's still the case.